Hello everyone. In this part 3 of our course Introduction to Data Science, I will give you a primer on statistical learning. I hope that by following this course, you want to follow more advanced courses in data science, in statistics, that will teach you more advanced statistical methods. For example, maybe you will take a first course in statistical learning that will teach you regression analysis. Basic linear regression, multivariate linear regression. You will maybe also explore generalized linear models, additive models. You will maybe also want to learn things on machine learning, like decision trees. You want to study cluster algorithms and so on. So you can take all these different courses that teach you different methods in order to tackle problems in data science. However, all these different methods, regression, clustering, machine learning, they all try to solve the same common problem. And in this part 3, we want to focus on that common problem that each of the different methods is trying to solve. So in that respect, this part 3 is a very general theoretical framework in which you can put all the different machine learning algorithms. So in this part 3, we will do the following. First of all, we will focus on the question, what is statistical learning? If you do regression, if you do machine learning, decision trees, maybe even neural networks, that's all statistical learning. So what is that? What is the problem you're trying to solve there in a very general setting? Then we will be a bit more specific and look at the different types of learning problems. You will have supervised, unsupervised learning. You will have regression, you have classification. So what all these different problems are, we will look at that in the second section. Then we will move to the more mathematical part where we will give the basic foundation of statistical learning. What is the problem and what is the mathematical solution to that problem, and how can statistical learning, how can different algorithms help you to solve that problem from a data perspective? And then in the last two parts, we will first focus on how to test a model. So you can build models, you can do the mathematics for the models, but then how you decide if a model is a good model, that's of course a very important question. We will focus on that question in section 4. And then finally in section 5, I will try to make a link between what is data science, the thing that we described in part 1, and how is that related with what I try to explain you in this part 3 on predictive analytics and statistical learning. When we use a certain statistical method, then that method can help us to detect possible relationships that exist between the variables in your data set. For example, assume you have a data set with two variables, x and y. Then you want to know, is there a relationship possible between x on the one end and y on the other end? And assume that y is something you want to predict. Y is, for example, the sales over the next year. It would be good if you are the CEO of a certain company, if you can know more or less what will be your sales for the next year. Will it be very high, very low? That is important information. Or Y could be the value of Bitcoin for the next year. If you know where Bitcoin is going next year, then that can help you to know, should I buy or should I sell? Or maybe you are an insurance company, car insurance, and you want to know what will be the number of claims we have to pay to our policyholders because they had accidents. So you always want to predict something. And if there is a relationship between X and Y, where Y is a thing you want to predict, then maybe that information about the relationship can help you to improve your predictions, to make better predictions, be more accurate on what will happen, and hopefully that will make your business better. However, if you use data, of course, data is about things that already happened. It's about the value of Bitcoin and the market in general over the last years, past historical information. Or it can be your car insurance portfolio that you followed for the last year. And of course, if you want to make predictions, think about Bitcoin, think about the number of claims, then predictions are most relevant when they are about the future. So what you always do is you have data at your disposal to improve your predictions, but you are going to use historical data to make predictions about the future. So assume that we have our statistical methods, then we hope that we can use our clever statistical methods to discover new hidden relationships that we did not yet know. So we can exploit this new information to hopefully make more money in the future. However, it can happen that you maybe cannot make a very good prediction based on the available data. You have to make a guess. You have a rough idea of where the prediction will be going, but then you can wait, and over time, new data will become available. And now there are also lots of statistical techniques that will update themselves, that will take new information to improve the predictions. So along the way, your methods will learn and will become smarter and be able to make better predictions. So assume Y is the variable that you want to predict, the number of claims, the value of your favorite stock. And that is what we call the response variable. That is the variable of interest. And we have what we call predictor variables, X1, X2, all the way to XP, that should help us to estimate Y. So we have our predictor values and we want to estimate Y. And given the information of the X values, hopefully we can make a better prediction of Y than without information of these X values. So we have response variable, that is the one that we are interested in. We have predictor variables. These are the variables that help us to make better predictions. And we always use this notation X with the bar to denote the row vector containing all the X variables. For example, think about the car insurance example. Then we want to estimate the number of claims that will be or why, and we can use information about the location where someone is living, about the age and so on to make better predictions. Let's go a bit further on the car insurance example. Assume you have a car insurance data set. It means you have information of the policyholders of a car insurer over the last couple of years. Say for the last 5 years, you can observe who was in the portfolio, you can observe different features of your policyholders, where they live, how much they drive, what car they drive, and so on. And you can observe how many accidents does each policyholder have each year. And what is your response variable? In this case, assume it's the risk class. So it's not just the number of claims someone has, no, it's the class. And assume, very simple, that we will classify drivers as good or bad drivers. Right? So we want to know for each policyholder, is it a good or a bad driver? Because you want to keep the good drivers in your portfolio, because these are the drivers that pay premiums each year, but they do not have a lot of claims. And that is what you like as an insurer. The bad drivers, on the other hand, these are drivers that make a lot of claims, so you have to pay a lot to compensate for these claims. For bad drivers, maybe you want to remove the bad drivers from your portfolio, or at least you want to ask these bad drivers to pay an extra fee on the premium, because you say, well, because you make that many accidents, you have to pay a bit extra compared to the other good drivers. So you want to categorize drivers into classes. The question is then, how do we determine the risk class of, for example, an existing policyholder? So assume that you have someone today who is already in your portfolio for 5 years. Then you want to assign the class for this policyholder for the next year. Of course, you can say, well, we take the same class as we had for the last year. Maybe last year that was a good driver, so next year it will also be a good driver. Or if it was a bad driver, next year it will also be a bad driver. But it can happen that these classes change over time. For example, if it was a bad driver last year, maybe that is because this policyholder just got his driver's license. And then it's not strange that you start in the class with the bad drivers. But over time, you can evolve to a good driver. So we have to check each year, use our data analysis to see, is it now time to move this driver from the bad to the good drivers? Or maybe we assigned the wrong class. Maybe we assigned this driver as being a good driver, but then if we see several accidents over the last couple of years, maybe we have to have a look at the data and say, well, actually, we have to reduce the class and we have to move the driver from the good to the bad class. So each year you have the new exercise of assigning the risk classes. It can also be that you want to determine the risk class for a new policyholder. Different from the existing policyholders, you have no information of this policyholder. You did not observe this policyholder over several years. So you cannot use the information you have from the past to make predictions for the next year. For this new policyholder, you have to say, well, we look at our own policyholders and we learn about the behavior of these policyholders, and that information will be used to give you a class. And then we assign a class to this new policyholder, and then over the years we get more and more information on this policyholder that can help us to update its class. The problem is that the risk class of a policyholder is random, and therefore it's unpredictable. You want to predict it, but actually it's unpredictable. It means that you can use all your tools and find after several computations that a certain policyholder should have the risk class a good driver. But then you directly know, well, it can be that it is a bad driver, that we classify the driver as a good driver, but it turns out that it is a bad driver. There is always the possibility that you misclassify your observation. And in that sense, you always are guessing for the solution. It's not that you know what is the risk class, you are guessing that is the risk class. I think it's this, but it could be the other class. So that's important to realize, that you're trying to solve a problem, but at the end, you're guessing the solution. However, there is good news, at least some good news. We can improve the guessing. We can make this guess more scientific. For example, we have predictor variables. If we want to guess the risk class of a policyholder, we can see, well, this policyholder is a male, very young, had a lot of accidents in the past, drives a very fast car. That information can help us with the guessing, because we can investigate the relationship between our predictor variables on one hand and the response on the other hand. Because we know from the past, these were the good drivers, these were the bad drivers. These are the predictor variables for the good drivers, these for the bad drivers. Maybe we see some patterns. So by investigating how the predictor variables are related with the response variable, we can improve the guessing. And for that we have data available. As I already said, it's mostly data from the past. So we have information about what happened in the past. We learn about these past observations to make predictions about the future, to make better, to make scientific guesses of what will happen in the future. We can use statistical methods to make our guessing more scientific. Do not just say anything for our future risk class, but use available data, the predictor variables, try to find the right relationships, and then make a scientific guess. This driver is good or bad. Well, even if we can solve that problem in that way, there are still some remaining questions, important remaining questions. The first is, of course, how reliable is my outcome? If you say that, well, I think this person is a good driver, but it's very likely there is still a 40% probability that it's a bad driver, then, well, you have a guess, but, well, it's not very reliable. It's very likely that you are wrong. So we have to somehow assess the reliability of your outcome. How good, how accurate is your prediction? And how likely is it that you are wrong? Another, even more important question is, what happens if you are wrong? So from the first question, you can say, well, I'm pretty sure that I'm right. Maybe I'm very accurate when I predict the future class of my driver. There is only a very small probability that it will be a bad driver if I say it's a good driver and the other way around. So we have a very reliable prediction. However, even if your prediction is very reliable, it can still happen that you are wrong. Small probability, but you can be wrong. It's still guessing, right? So you have to assess what happens if I guess wrong. Go back to the car insurance example. Assume that you have to predict the risk class of the driver. If you predict good, it turns out to be bad, you're wrong. If you predict bad, it turns out to be good, you're also wrong. However, in this case, if you look at the problem from the insurance perspective, from a risk management perspective, then the misclassifications are not, the effect of the misclassifications is not symmetric. What do I mean? I mean that if you say that someone is a bad driver, then you will increase the premium, probably. You will say, well, I think you are a bad driver, you will have many claims, so we will put a penalty on your premium. You have to pay a bit more. If you increase the premium for your policyholder, but it turns out that it was actually a good driver, then, well, you received more premium and you didn't pay a lot of claims in the future. So that's actually a good situation. You are a bit prudent there. However, if you make a mistake in your direction, you say that someone is a good driver, but it turns out that that actually is a bad driver, then that policyholder will generate more claims than you expect. So it will cost you more than you expect in the next year for this particular policyholder. That is a situation you want to avoid. You want to avoid that you charge a premium which is too low compared to the risk. So classifying someone as good while it is a bad driver, that is the misclassification you want to avoid. The other way around, saying it's a bad driver while it is a good driver, well, that's not too harmful for your business. Another example is, assume you are trying to predict how deep a river is, right? Without really measuring it, you use lots of information on the river and the environment to see how deep is this river. And you want to see, well, how accurate is my prediction and what happens if I'm wrong. Assume now you are predicting how deep the river is because you want to jump into the river from a very tall bridge. In that case, you better make sure that you do not predict the river is very deep while in reality it's not deep. Because what happens if my guess is wrong? Well, that is kind of disastrous, right? So you have the prediction on one hand, and then the effects, the consequences of wrong predictions on the other hand. And why is the response variable? And why is, for example, how deep is the river? Or the risk class of your driver? That is the variable you are looking at, you are interested in. You want to predict why. And in order to help you predict why, you have the predictors that you store in X. And we assume that there is the following relationship between Y and X. Y is equal to a function applied on the predictor variables X plus an error term epsilon. Let's first look at the first term. The function f is what we call the regression function. The regression function tells you how x is related to y. And of course, we have to assume that such a function f exists, because without such a function f, there is no relation between x and y, so there is no need to apply a statistical method. So there is some function, and that can be a very extremely complex function, but there is a function that tells you, well, if this is your predictor variable x, then this will be your y. So that will be the systematic information that is contained in your predictor variables about your response variable y. So we can learn what y will be using our predictor variables and connecting them via the function f with y. However, we can never know exactly what is y. Y is not deterministic, y is a random variable. Why is that? Because epsilon is a random variable. And therefore, predicting y means that we are guessing. We are guessing as good as we can, but we are guessing. On average, y is equal to f of x, because on average, epsilon is zero. But sometimes it can be a bit higher, sometimes it can be a bit lower. So the variance of epsilon, the fluctuations of epsilon, will give you information how accurate can you guess your y variable. So the epsilon is a random variable, meaning you cannot predict what the value of epsilon will be. It's the unsystematic information. In statistical learning, we have different statistical methods. For example, you can start with the very simple linear models. Make things a bit more complicated by going to the generalized linear models, going to the additive models, or going to the more complex Gauss process regression, or go to machine learning, decision trees, neural networks, and so on. You have many, many models going from very simple to extremely complex. However, each of these models is trying to do the same thing. They're all trying to estimate, to approximate the regression function f using the available data. What was the regression function f? F is a function that links your predictor variables x to your y. And that is the holy grail in statistical learning. If you can know f, you know everything that you can know, because you cannot know the error term epsilon, but you can try to find f. The better you find f, the better your model is. Why do you want to estimate f? The first application is, of course, prediction. Predicting the value of Bitcoin, predicting stock returns, predicting the number of claims, and so on. You are looking at your response variables, at your predictor variables x, and you try to see, well, how can I use the information that I have on my predictor variables, on my function f, to get a better estimate for my response y. The better your approximation of f is, the better your prediction will be. Important here is that you see that what the function f is exactly is not really important for your prediction problem. Of course, you want to know what f is because you want to get as close as possible to that function. But what the relation exactly is between x and y is of no importance. You just want to get a better approximation of f. That is different when you do inference. Because with inference, you are investigating the relationship between x and y. You are trying to understand what happens with my number of claims when I go from males to females. It means that I'm not really interested in predicting the number of claims. You are looking at the effect of a variable or maybe multiple variables on your response variable. So in order to do inference, you want to understand the function of f. It's not just that you want to come as close as possible to your function f. You want to understand, how does it look? Has it an exponential form or a linear form or something like that, right? So inference is interested in the function f. Prediction is interested in how close can I get to that function f.